On this episode of Acoustic Tuesday, we're going to talk about an unassuming guitar gadget. I'm going to share with you a mind-blowing book, and I have something that I've been listening to that I want to share with you. And of course, Noah and I have to continue our dart game, and I have a little trivia for you. All that and more right after this. The Acoustic Tuesday Show is brought to you by tonysacousticchallenge.com. Welcome to Acoustic Tuesday. I'm Tony Polecastro from tonysacousticchallenge.com, where we're all about expanding our quality of life through music and having as much fun as possible with our guitars. I am delightfully joined today by Noah Jacob Heckman Jr., the first.
Thank you.
As well as Levi Kawila, the man with the technical plan. And I gotta say, as I normally do, you guys look fantastic today.
Oh, thanks, Tony.
Thanks, man. Thanks for being here. It's just outstanding. You know, normally on Acoustic Tuesday, this is only the second one, and I'm pretty pumped about this second version of Acoustic Tuesday, second episode rather. And normally I just kick into my list of acoustic guitar geekiness, but before I do that today, I have a trivia question for you, a guitar geek trivia, if you will. So while we're talking about acoustic guitar geekiness today, I want you to keep this question in mind, and at the end of the episode, I'm going to share with you the answer to it. Your question for the day is, in what year did Martin Guitars start implementing adjustable truss rods? One more time. In what year did Martin Guitars start implementing adjustable truss rods? Be sure to stay tuned for the answer. It will be coming up at the end of the episode. And with the question foundation laid, let's dive right in to my list of acoustic guitar geekiness for this week. First of all, I want to introduce to you an unassuming guitar gadget. Now, we don't often think of picks as guitar gadgets, but I get asked all the time what guitar pick I use, and I use the Dunlop Altex Sharp 2.0 millimeter pick. It's a little unassuming gadget, but I have found it to be old, we'll call it old reliable, if you will. I've tried the picks that cost 40, 30 bucks, and they're awesome. I've tried the Red Bears, love them. Tried the Blue Chips, love them. Tried the Wiegands, love them. But I can lose those, and I often do lose picks. If I lose the Dunlop Altex 2.0 sharp pick, I don't have to worry about it. So I absolutely love this pick. The reasons I love it, in terms of its functionality, I love the material. It's very wear resistant. And I actually love the shape, and I'll tell you why. The sharp point, actually, after you use it for a while, gets a little bit of a bevel on it, which leads to really, really wonderful tone and great pick string feel. So this is one of my favorite guitar gadgets, and I don't leave home without a pocket full of them, except for today. I had to borrow Noah's. But
I want it back.
I will be sure to give you the pick back, I promise. It's just right here, and I'll give it to you after I destroy you in darts. But yeah. On to my next item of the day, and that is what I'm currently listening to. And I want to share with you guys an album that I absolutely love. It is an album by Kelly Joe Phelps. It's called Tunesmith Retrofit, and the tune that I'm absolutely loving off of this album right now is Tight to the Jar. I'm going to go ahead and give you guys a listen, and then I'll tell you a little bit about why I love this song so much. So here's a listen for you.
It's a ditch, okay. I have shoes and a blanket in my head, resting light on a stone. Though it's hard, it's still rounded with a pocket for brains, or what goes for in halls under rooftops. We'll sing another blistering ballad. Grandma, the melody's sweet till it rolls out the ears, and the beer flows free as advice.
Now, I'll tell you why I love this particular album so much. The song Tight to the Jar in particular is my favorite. It takes me back to living in Chicago, taking the train to school, and just plugging in my iPod. It was huge. It was like the size of a cassette tape at the time. And I just would listen to this nonstop. I love the way that Kelly plays, his vocals, the finger picking, it's all there. But what really shines through the most with this particular album is that Kelly Joe is kind of one of those players that is just in the moment and just reacts to whatever's happening. When you see him live, he doesn't do the same thing twice. It's just a whole new experience every time. And for an album to capture that, I think it's pretty amazing. And I think this album does a wonderful job. So there you have it, Kelly Joe Smith's Tunesmith Retrofit. And I highly, highly, highly recommend. Unfortunately, Kelly Joe is not touring currently. He's taking a little bit of a musical break, but certainly want to say thanks, Kelly Joe, for making some awesome music.
Is that Kelly Joe Phelps or Smith?
Kelly Joe Phelps.
Okay.
Did I mispronounce it?
I think you may have.
It's possible. I think the Calumet Farm, which is what's here in my glass, might be kicking in. Kelly Joe Phelps is exactly okay. What I wanted to say and what I thought I had said. On to the next item on my list today, and this is one that will indeed blow your mind. This is a book that just opened up a door for me in terms of understanding the guitar and, more importantly, understanding chords. Now, the book I'm going to recommend here, the book that I'm going to tout, if you will, is called The Art of Chords by Stéphane Gagnon. Maybe.
It's Gagnon.
Is it really?
Yeah. You know how I know this, Tommy?
How do you know this?
I was thinking about this. We were just talking about my days back in drama in high school.
Yes.
And remember, I was talking to you about my counterpart, the leading lady.
Yes, yes.
Her last name was Gagnon.
Really?
Totally.
Well, there you go. It's Stéphane Gagnon. And he wrote a book called The Art of Chords. And the reason why I like this book so much is because it demystifies the nebulous clutter about understanding chords. It gets rid of all of the, remember, you know, a million shapes, and it really isolates what a chord's made of, how to look at chords, how to manipulate chords. And essentially what you realize when going through this book is that you don't have to remember all of those shapes. And although those chord posters that are huge and contain all those chord shapes are really cool, this book almost makes that poster obsolete. So I strongly recommend this book. So if you've ever asked yourself the question, what's the difference between a major and minor chord? How on earth do I remember all of these chords? Or if you've ever asked yourself, what on earth is a diminished chord, an augmented chord, an add nine chord, a suspended chord, whatever the case may be, this book has it. And it's not an overwhelming book. It's a really thin book, maybe 50 pages at most, but it is an absolute goldmine of information. So please check that book out. Now, I do have some practice philosophy, and I want to answer the question this week. Are your guitar heroes leading you astray? But before we even go down that road, I want to check in with Noah and see if we've got some small wins to report.
Absolutely, Tony.
Well, first, while you're queuing that up, let me first explain what a small win actually is. A small win is a victory, great or small, that you experience in your guitar journey. Maybe you've changed your guitar strings for the first time. Maybe you finally learned how to bar that F chord. Maybe you got your guitar in tune and you're just starting. Those are all small wins, and we're all about celebrating them. So with that, Noah, let's do those small wins.
All right, Michelle N. It's funny how at the beginning of a lesson, I get overwhelmed and think I won't get it. But within 10 to 15 minutes, the whole thing becomes clear. And she also says, she has kind of like a double win here.
Awesome.
She says she's now able to produce sound with the hammer-ons, so that is a small win.
Killer. That's outstanding.
James B., love the hammer-on in the triplet, getting exposed to all kinds of new stuff and being able to apply it is a small win for me.
That's huge.
And Andy A., he says, tried the metronome for the first time at 80 beats per minute. At first, I thought it was the wrong choice to go with this lick that I'm working on. But after a couple of minutes, I was able to play the first measure on beat compared to a month ago when just the thought of using a metronome was wishful thinking. I am definitely making progress. Mucho gracias, Tony.
Awesome. That's killer. Using a metronome can be a little intimidating. And when it clicks, it's awesome.
Totally can be. So and you probably do the same. when students would come in, you pretty much mentioned it from the get-go.
Yeah,
and absolutely. Start encouraging the use of the metronome.
Absolutely. It's a fantastic tool and great small win to share for sure. And speaking of playing guitar and just being an overall guitar geek, having small wins, everything that comes along with being a guitar geek, I want to talk about guitar heroes. Right now, right here, and I want to ask you the question. I want you to look inside and say, hey, are my guitar heroes leading me astray? Are they leading me down the wrong road? And the answer is maybe. But here, let me divulge a little bit more information. Having guitar heroes is necessary. I have a list of guitar heroes. Noah, I'm sure you have a list of bass and or guitar heroes as well.
Yes, I do.
Good. We all have them, and it's necessary to have them, but it's also necessary to keep in mind that we need to use them for inspiration and motivation and not a point of comparison. Because, quite frankly, I would love to fingerpick just like Tommy Emmanuel. I would love to flatpick just like Bryan Sutton, David Greer, Doc Watson. I mean, we can just keep going for days. But I do myself a disservice if I start comparing myself to how they play, because the reality is that I'm different. My unique musical approach is different, and yours is as well. We all have a different, unique musical approach, a sonic fingerprint, if you will, and we need to celebrate that. If we all played the exact same, music would be a pretty one-dimensional, lame thing to listen to. But all of our unique approaches make it so amazing. So I urge you to please use your guitar heroes as a source of motivation, as a source of inspiration, as a source of, wow, that person is amazing with their unique approach to music. But don't compare yourself, because really you're kind of shooting yourself in the foot. They're different. I'm different than Noah. I'm different than Levi. I'm trying to learn drums. Levi's a drummer. Levi shows me things on drums, and it's really interesting. And I compare myself to Levi, but I shouldn't. I should use him as inspiration.
It's really interesting.
Because he's an awesome drummer. And I should be like, wow, Levi's a killer drummer. And he's sharing things with me from his unique musical standpoint. So bottom line, use your guitar heroes as motivation and inspiration, not as a point of comparison. Now, we got one more thing before the dart battle continues to rage on.
Can I jump in real quick?
You can, please.
I'd like to add on to your thought there.
Yeah.
You know, when I hit that crucial adolescent stage of development, and the bands that I was introduced to, Rush, Dream Theater, Yes. I mean, what you're saying, it was going through my mind the whole time, because getting into either drums or bass, especially bass for me and singing, watching Geddy Lee was just phenomenal. And then right away you think, oh man, I got to be able to play that killer groove while I'm singing, while playing keyboards with my feet.
Yeah.
And then maybe having to move the microphone with your nose as you're switching to some sort of other instrument. So I get you.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. It's better to be inspired and motivated instead of being like, wow, I can't do that. I must not be good. It's not a black and white thing. There's a lot of gray areas in music. So we got to celebrate that for sure. And one way to celebrate that is to, of course, practice. I like to say put in at least 10 minutes a day. And speaking of practice, last week just released a lesson on pull-offs, and I think you're totally going to dig it. In fact, I pulled a clip from it to share it with you here right now on today's show. So Levi, if you could please share that clip. Yes. I want you to imagine yourself in the third grade. Your buddy's sitting in front of you. You have a rubber band on the end of your finger, and you're about to flick it at the back of his head. That feeling of the rubber band coming off the edge of your fingertip is exactly how I want your pull-offs to feel. Let me explain. So from that fretted note, and again, I'm using my middle finger on the second fret of the D string here. I'm going to fret that note. I'm going to pick the string. I'm going to pull slightly down and then let that string kind of just roll off the edge of my fingertip. Just like that. That's going to give that string, that pulled off, the pull-off, it's going to give it a little extra oomph so you can match that volume to the first note. It's a nice little trick that I like to use, and when I was first taught it, it made a huge difference in my pull-offs. But it all... Now, what you just saw was one brief part of that lesson. In that lesson, I actually go through three different tips on pull-offs, and at the end, I share with you an exercise on how to build stronger, better-sounding pull-offs. So be sure to check that out. And as with everything I've mentioned thus far, you can find links to everything from the pick to the book to Kelly Joe Phelps' album in the description below. Now, that being said, Noah, we've got some business to deal with. We got to play some darts.
Bring it on.
Now, I just for the sake of my recollection and to make sure everybody knows and we're all on the same page, how does the dart battle actually work?
So here's how it works. You are a bourbon man.
Accurate.
I am a scotch guy. And so whoever wins... No, whoever loses... Man, we rehearsed this.
I know.
Whoever loses has to give a bottle to the winner.
Correct.
Right? So, if you win, I have to go and buy a bottle of bourbon.
Bourbon. It's okay.
Bourbon.
Yeah.
Thank you. For both of us to enjoy together.
Right.
If I win, you have to go and buy a bottle of scotch for both of us to enjoy together. And pretty simple.
And that's how it is. And with that said, I think we should play some darts.
Okay, Noah, you ready?
Ready.
Hold on. I'm going to put the dart cam on and go. Is that a nine?
That's a nine.
Okay. Awesome.
I'm coming up in the world.
That's a nine.
Okay. All right, Tony, going to the dart cam.
Okay.
All right, hit it.
Oh.
Oh!
Oh, man. This is not looking good for Noah.
Well, we should do a little bit of a score update just to make sure we really have things dialed in. Last week, Noah shot a one, respectable one, made it on the board, and I shot a 12. And this week, Noah shot a nine, which brings him to a grand total of 10, mm-hmm. and I shot a 20, which brings me to a grand total of 32, which is pretty interesting.
Correct math.
Thank you, because you're going to need to double check me today. Yeah. Which is interesting because 32 was my number when I played hockey, so that feels good. I feel right at home.
I'm glad that that happened for you, because next time it's going to be a different story.
Okay. Okay, fair enough. We have two more weeks of the dart challenge. Current score is 32 to 10.
Yep.
And looking forward to the new bourbon that we're going to get here. So you guys are probably wondering.
I see what you did there.
Yeah. You guys are probably wondering, in what year did Martin start implementing adjustable truss rods? Well, I'm here to tell you that it was all the way in 1985. When Martin started implementing adjustable truss rods in their new models, which is pretty crazy. I was 2 years old when they did that.
What was your guess going to be, Noah?
Mine?
Yeah.
Oh, like 1910? All I know about Martin guitars is that they've been around for a while, so I'm just going to go old.
I was going to go for 1997.
Really?
Well, I had to be on the other end of the spectrum. It's like Price is Right.
Oh, I see what the $1 bet. I see what you did there. Okay, fair enough. Yeah, it was 1985, which is kind of cool. I think it's a little bit of a
Back to the Future.
Yeah. Another one I'll have to put on the list to see. Okay, well, I do want to thank you guys for being here with us on Acoustic Tuesday today, but I have one more item, a very, very important business. I want to ask you guys to please, in the comments below, tell us what you thought of the show. What did you love? What did you want to see more of? Anything you feel, please tell us in the comments below. And with that, Noah, we had some comments from last week, and I'd love for you to share those
with
us.
Yes, indeed.
That was some awesome feedback.
Oh, absolutely. Let me give a few shout-outs. We had quite a few comments to Caleb H., Donnie L., Wilden G., The Mini Brewer, Scotty G, Mark M, Thomas C, AJ P, Fred P, Jeff S, Stephen P, Gerald, Michelle, Devin, Robert, Ronnie, tons of peeps. Here's some comments we got. Main 932 said, actually, this is a good idea. Maybe a brief lesson on a particular song style, or, and I was wondering whether or not to share this, or realizing bourbon is far superior to that other brackish wastewater mentioned. Yeah, well, the next one comes from George V. Love the chat and the music, but for Christ's sakes, move those guitars before you throw darts.
Well, I'm happy to say that comment was taken to heart.
I
mean, they're over there.
I'm noticing already. Yeah, I don't think we realized how where they were when we threw last week.
I was so excited. I just, it slipped my mind, which is horrible.
He goes on, George, and he says, okay, I'm a Brit, and I grew up playing darts, and you can bet that sooner or later a dart is going to hit a wire, bounce off the board, and stick in that Martin you have on the stand. So, well said, George.
Point taken.
Yes, point taken. Michelle V., absolutely fun and informative. We'll look forward to next week. I love that you're always doing something new and interesting.
Awesome.
And,
thank you.
Let me throw one more in there from Den M. Tony, Acoustic Tuesday rocks. More song and artist recommendations, please.
Cool.
Also, more guitar repair building links is always appreciated.
Absolutely.
Awesome idea for a weekly guitar geek gathering.
Oh, killer. And that's exactly what Acoustic Tuesday is. It is a guitar geek gathering, a celebration of guitar geekness, if you will. And I just want to thank you for celebrating your guitar geekness with us here today on this Acoustic Tuesday. I wish you the absolute best Tuesday I possibly can. And I'm sure these fine gentlemen do as well. And
absolutely.
Please make sure to tune into Acoustic Tuesday. It happens every Tuesday at 10 a.m. Mountain Time on YouTube or Facebook. And just celebrate and let your inner guitar geek flag fly, as they say. So until next week, cheers to you, and we'll see you on Acoustic Tuesday.
It's a ditch, okay. I have shoes and a blanket in my head, resting light on a stone. Though it's hard, it's still rounded with a pocket for brains, or what goes for, it all's under.